Next up, we have Alex Reese. He's going to be talking about device removal on another. So this is another new feature. I think it might be very interesting to think about this in the context of the previous talk about shrivel magnetic disks. So just a little extra idea that we're going through in there. Save that for questions.
If a bunch of writes have been coalesced together for a bunch of files,
had a single mapping entry from all of these coalesced writes from your disk to the new disk. And this would presumably save us a lot of space. And then we would, on the read and freeze, as before, we would look up the old block pointer in this mapping of segments. And we would translate it into the new segment. And of course, we have to store this mapping on disk and in memory as before. And to be a little bit more concrete, I'll kind of explain what I mean by segment. The mapping is just a mapping from the old offset and length of some allocated segment on disk to a new disk and a new segment. A new disk and a new offset. And so by doing this, by having these, by doing it based on segments rather than based on blocks, we can save a lot of space because you can have more than one block per allocated segment. In addition to that, there's this, because we're going on allocated segments based on blocks, we can potentially do some cute things with how we're constructing this mapping. Such as construct the mapping iteratively in LBA order rather than iterating through the blocks in the scan order, which could potentially give us some performance. And of course, it's challenging. Right? There's things we have to pay attention to as we do this. And I'll go into a little bit more into each of these things in just a bit. But at a high level, we have to make sure that we minimize the effect we have on the system. We want to make sure that the workflow to a user is understandable and coherent and is not weird gotchas, such as, oops, I accidentally added a pool to the disk to the pool. And we want to make sure we interact well with other ZFS features, such as checksums, viewing, snapshot, and RayZ. For example, we'll get more into this later. I'll pause here for a moment just to make sure everyone is on the same page with the high level rule of this course. Any questions before I get there? All right. So most, one of the most interesting things we try to do is we wanted to make sure our most interesting design goal was we wanted to minimize the effect we had on the system while doing a device model. So we looked at the way similar processes have occurred in the past, such as scrub. So we have a way scrub worked in the past is it does a time slicing in the sync thread between doing scrub IOs and doing normal asynchronous write IOs. And this time slicing means that neither one of them could really go at full bandwidth they would otherwise be able to go. And scrub operations can take a long time, and can have strange effects on the performance of your system. And so we wanted to come up with a new way to do this background copy action. And so our plan is to do it with a separate thread that does most of the activity in the I/O in open context. And then we'll update the sync thread with its progress as it goes on. And as a consequence, we'll be able to have, it'll be easier to reason about the performance of this operation. Because our reason will be, this is a thread that's doing some workload, rather than this is a strange time slicing of the activity. And so let me kind of walk you through what that might look like. So here we have a pool of two disks. There's the blue disk and the green disk, and the blue segments are allocated, the gray segments are not allocated, the green segments are also allocated. And so we want to remove the blue disk. We start the removal by pointing the copy thread at the bottommost OVA address, and then it iterates through all the allocated segments on the disk in order. So the first thing we can do is we skip the first allocated segment. We have this information from the space maps, so we just skip to the first allocated segment on the disk. And then what it does is it issues the I/O in open context and moves on. So you'll note at this point, the on-disk format has, we haven't updated the mapping of disk, we haven't updated anything, and the copy thread has moved on to the next thing and issued the I/O in the backtrack. Sometime later, move on to the next segment. Sometime later, the write completes, and the sync thread will, after the write completes, update in memory and on disk. It can construct a mapping, you can see the little pink arrow. It'll construct a mapping of the old location to the new location. And the sync thread does this as the sync thread in the sync context automatically. So you'll see what's going on here is we can continue iterating. The open context thread, which is doing the copies, operates in open context and goes as fast as it can go, given the normal throttling in ZFS. And the sync thread updates the metadata that's consistently during every sync. And we don't have a strange slicing. But every now and then we'll have, this does lead to some interesting behavior. So we're up here in our picture now. We already have one of the first interesting things we have to look at, think about with our problem, which is the copy thread is about to copy this last blue segment. And there's not a big enough space on the other edge. And so like, these are the type of things that we have to look into with remove. In this case, the natural thing we decided to do is to actually split this region somewhat arbitrarily in the middle or somewhere into two regions, two segments that we then copy over. And then when we can start mapping, the mapping actually has this split in the middle of this okay, segment into two mapping areas. You'll no doubt imagine that this can be kind of interesting because we're iterating through the allocated segments on disk. Well, from a technical perspective, we're really iterating through using the space map information. But at that level, we don't actually know where the boundary between the blocks are. You know, if you have a 4K space map block, and we cut in the middle of that, then we have to do some interesting stuff later in the read path to reconstruct IOs. So this is some of the stuff that's going on in the background. Once we finish the removal, we can then mark the device as indirect, and we'll come back to it later. And we have to actually preserve the fact that this device was allocated. We have to preserve its VDEV number for all time, and we have to preserve its mapping for all time. It's because we can't rewrite the blocks. So you know, block ID 4 offset 400 will always ever be this indirect VDEV from producer millisecond. Here's some bullet points to kind of explain what I tried to show you pictures. What the scan thread does is, what the copy removal thread does is it iterates through all the space maps in LVA order and issues IOs to perform their copies, you know, to do a read and to allocate a new location, do a write to the new location. And it all does all that in open context. And then the sync thread before it completes starts. The very first thing it does when it starts syncing out the information for that transaction group is it waits for the IOs assigned to this transaction group to complete. And then up creates a mapping in memory and puts it on the disk. But there's an interesting thing that happened here. So we were iterating over the space map. We were using the space maps as our primary thing to iterate over the disk and identify the allocated segments, but we can reach a really complicated question. In addition to the previous mentioned complicated question of the split blocks, we have this question of what to do about frees, right? Because if someone were to free a space map we were iterating over, then we could have strange things like if we freed a space map we were iterating over, and then they actually freed the data on the old disk, or maybe they freed the data on the new disk after we've done the copy, but then what if our write came in after? Like, it gets complicated. That's kind of an open question for us. The initial idea we had was to just defer freeze for the disk entirely until after the removal completed. A removal we expect to take on the order of hours to days, not weeks. So maybe this is okay, but you know, for a disk with a lot of churn, for a pool with a lot of churn, or when we're trying to reclaim space, this could get potentially devastating. So we're investigating other options, including not deferring frees for frees that are far enough in the future that they won't conflict with the actual IOs. And that's kind of a question where we're still working on that. There's, of course, before we even get to interacting with other ZFS features, we have to make this understandable to users. So this whole idea of the deferred freeze is kind of a thing that could be a surprise to a user. That during the process of removal, you might start really acute, like apparently leaking space in the pool. Because the freeing that you end up having a lot of data that hadn't quite been freed yet. And so we have to do things like predict the amount of space that will be used by the removal and try to add some sort of slop factor to deal with this deferred freeze space. In addition, the fact that we have to persist the mapping in memory for all time is kind of a surprising thing for some customers. or could be a surprising thing, and could be potentially a lot of memory. So we have to put some visibility into that so the customers don't accidentally close their machines. And we also have optimizations we're working on apps to try to minimize, even reduce, even eliminate that memory, which I'll get to in a couple slides. But that's definitely a problem that we need to make immediately apparent and visible to the user. And of course, we don't want the use problem. The customer accidentally removes the device and then can't recover. So cancellation is actually a pretty important feature here. We really say, roll back and stop removing the device. So these are all features we're working on as we're developing the device removal. Device removal interacts, the way we're doing it interacts very smoothly with a bunch of other ZFS, a bunch of ZFS features. Giving compression, snapshots, it doesn't really interact with it, so it'll just work naturally. Checksums is an interesting thing because we're iterating over the space maps rather than iterating through the normal scan path, we don't actually have the checksums of the block pointers we're issuing the copies for. And so this probably necessitates doing a scrub after the removal in order to make sure that we don't lose the data before we tell the customer they can remove the device. But we think that the ability to iterate through the space maps in OBA order and the ability to have mappings for one reading is probably worth it. Probably worth making the customer do a scrub after the removal. Also with RAID Z, it doesn't really work, or it kind of works. You'll only be able to remove RAID Z devices if all top level devices have the same RAID Z. And then the reason why this is tricky is because because we're iterating through space maps, we don't have access to we have to make assumptions about the data, and RAID Z makes assumptions about data and the array information where they're located. And since we're iterating through the space maps, we don't necessarily have that information. And so we can't actually do a faithful job of talking over pools where you have different RAID Z configurations for top level devices. There are, some interesting performance things that we've been looking at as part of this feature. The first thing you might think of is the cost of doing the actual indirection, of doing the lookup through these maze mappings. We believe this cost to be minimal because the mappings will be stored in memory, or hopefully as much in memory as possible. And we also don't believe that will be very important performance. But the memory overhead is pretty substantial. So when we take a look at some customer storage pools and how fragmented they are, and we see about a gigabyte per terabyte of storage. The mapping would take about a gigabyte per about a terabyte of storage, which is pretty substantial. And so there's things you can do to reduce that. You can map rather than mapping just allocated segments, you can map an entire fragmented region which would contain allocated segments and free segments. So let's say you have one megabyte on your device that you're trying to remove that's cheese cloth. You can then copy over the exact allocation, allocated free to the new device. And that way you can have one entry for potentially a bunch of different allocated segments. Other things we can do is for active file systems, you can rewrite BPs proactively for indirect blocks. So as we would have to rewrite an indirect block, we can often just go through the process of looking at the mapping entry where those would be and rewrite them to the final rest of the location. As a consequence, we would have to do less reads through the mapping tables. This is really where you can start to take advantage of some of the other things you can do. Like, for example, you could dynamically enable certain parts of the mapping so that we wouldn't have to keep the entire mapping in memory at all times. Or we could try to do garbage collection, try to identify when certain parts of the mapping have been freed and no longer need them. These are all things that we're working on. As you know, I imagine the feature's not quite ready, but we can still demo. We can't actually demo, we don't have network connectivity. But I can show you what it looks like it took us last night when we were working on the virtual house. So you can't see that all standing. then you just say is equal removes a disk, and then you can say status, which tells you how well it's, how far it's going, how long it's going to take, much like Google and Spark. I'm about done. I'm going to go back to the slide of the picture and ask if there's any questions.
So I don't know, just like, how does Google, because Google hopefully can't fail because you can, your navigator is going to fill up your disks, that feels like it has a pretty large implication on being able to actively rewrite stuff, because a removal can't necessarily succeed because of the capacity of the tool, like, the size of the data table. So I'm just curious how that's going to try and factor into that.
I'm going to try to re-articulate your question so that I think you hear it, hopefully I can make sure I'm answering the same question. I think your question is, it seems to me that a removal could fail because it ran out of space. What then?
Yes, basically, how did the impact of that on all the subsequent optimizations that we're talking about?
Yeah, so I think our plan for that is that exactly what I kind of mentioned the workflow here, is to do predict the amount of space it could theoretically maximum use ahead of time. And we can do a reservation of that. So that if we start the removal process, it will only fail, like it will use the reservation time to make sure it will succeed.
And then follow-up question I have also is the scrub. When you do the scrub, is the original disk removed still online? So you can do checksum verification?
Yeah, I think that you really want to do the scrub before you remove the original disk.
It feels like you can't not. Otherwise, basically, you're
going to
have.
My copy,
if I had a Ramsey error,
that's
a rooted problem,
then
I basically copy data back
and
check some
verification. No, you absolutely need to check some while you have the other disk online, so you can do repairs.
Yes, this seems to be a very painful process. So, my question is except for the groups that you look in the mirror, what other use cases do you see the device can do?
So the primary use case. For us, is customers have over-provisioned storage for a specific machine, and so they want to allocate that storage to a different machine.
Yes.
And
kind of add to that is they may not have over-provisioned initially, but they over-provisioned other resources like they ran out of CPU, they ran out of memory, so now they've moved workload up, and as a result, they have much more disk than they need.
Space map corruption would be a good problem for this. Thank you.
Does not directly address that.
Yeah, we don't have plans for that for the ground.
I mean, you can remove multiple devices.
Yeah,
and it's a question of doing multiple times over. Yeah, but I mean, that's fine. And each time you do that, it'll get new mapping and the review has to go, it might have to go through many mappers.
Consolidating those mappers would be a huge benefit.
So it's resolving consumption and also,
yes, we're looking them up ahead of time. When you were doing the renewal, getting rid of the intermediate links.
You could actually do that every each time you discover a variable, you can do that.
Perhaps,
but the
primary use case for this seems to be people who forget the log or cache keyword. I mean, in that case, there's not a whole lot of data. So it seems like it'd be a pretty low overhead and easy fix for what you need to rebuild your pool. Sorry.
Or get
this somehow doesn't look right. It's created 5 years, so this is the same thing.
That's already
existed. Is there, oh, that's
the
Or
you're going to have 4 step.
Yeah, that's right. It's going to be 1 step.
We're getting confused for like Z-tool status as the fact that one of your peers is actually too far. The long here is so long.
Yes, that has the capacity to help confuse system engineers.
So, if the question is going to possibly be writing internet blocks proactively, why not just add a feature to your scroll to go reach to write every single internet block that is on its own media and then basically make it all go away so you wouldn't have essentially run.
So I'm talking about rewriting indirect blocks for active classes. Are you just talking about rewriting indirect blocks for also snapshots? Because that sounds hard. That sounds like being here, right?
Yeah, I'm just trying to explain our particular use case and why we actually
So that like our customers are actually running ZFS on top of, you know, sometimes tier one storage, which is not cheap. And you know, if we have to tell them like, oh, you accidentally added, you know, a couple of terabytes of storage to this, and now it's part of like we're using that forever. Sorry that you didn't want to do that.
I agree. So let me clarify my question on that. So I have many open ZFS systems that I take care of. And I have shells that each of them is more than 100 terabytes. So this translates, according to what I heard, to 100 gigabytes of memory used for the translation tables. If this is true, I can't afford to lose 100 gigabytes of my memory.
That's a worst case scenario, and that's one of the reasons that, you know, that we can tell you in advance how much memory it might use. And, you know, why we're talking about, like, extending this to doing garbage collection and stuff like that. But yeah, that's, I mean, certainly it is a concern, and you know, we're giving you enough information to make that decision.
It sounds like what you guys are doing is partial table, like we're continually adjusting the state. When some work is done, you're sort of adding more data information for the future work.
Yeah, but if that happens, that metric is based on total device size in worst case scenario. So,
it would have to be.
If your device is actually 90% full, then you can't get that out because you have to have more computers.
I actually had a very solid use case for this, and I have a like tool that I maintain. It has to be maintained until 2020. But 2015, in an archive mode. What I have retained about 300 terabytes of that, awesome to shrink that pool down and take all these disks that I would need spare so we can refresh the petabyte pool, make it last 2020. We're talking over $100,000 for the disks to make it last that long.
You see at this time?
But I just don't have to buy disks.